Good evening. I'm Bill Griswold, director of the Morgan Library and Museum, and it is my privilege to welcome you to this evening's program. This week, we at the Morgan celebrate a marvelous new exhibition, Churchill, The Power of Words. The exhibition tells the story of one of the greatest men in history. As an institution dedicated to the power of words to transform lives, we are enormously pleased and excited that it and all of you are here with us. The show is going to remain open until September the 23rd, and tonight our galleries will be open until 9 o'clock. The curator of the show is Alan Packwood, director of the Churchill Archives Center at the University of Cambridge, and I'm gratified to have this opportunity to thank him and to thank our own curator, Declan Kylie, as well as to acknowledge all those whose generous support has made the exhibition possible. We are thrilled about this evening's lecture, which is part of a series, the rest of which will take place at Hunter College. This is just the kind of collaborative effort that makes my job so rewarding. And so without further ado, it is an honor for me to introduce to you the president of Hunter College, one of the most energetic and engaging leaders whom I know, Jennifer Rapp.
Thank you, Bill. And on behalf of Hunter College, I want to thank you for your inspirational leadership of the iconic Morgan Library and Museum and for partnering with us tonight. We are honored to be part of the opening of this spectacular exhibition, and we hope this is just the first of many future collaborations. Thank you as well to today's speaker, Celia Sandys, the foremost steward of the great legacy of her grandfather, Sir Winston Churchill. Hunter College is proud to play a similar stewardship role in the legacy of one of Churchill's closest friends and allies, Franklin Roosevelt. Hunter's connection with Franklin and Eleanor goes back nearly a century, when the newlyweds moved into a beautiful double townhouse on 65th Street and developed a relationship with the college just three blocks north. They arranged for Hunter to purchase the house in 1940. As stewards of this vital piece of American history, Hunter's determined to be stewards of the entire Roosevelt legacy. Inspired by the wonderful Hunter motto, mihi cura futuri, the care of the future is mine, and by our belief that the good of the future depends on our understanding of the past, we recently restored the house and reopened it as the Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute at Hunter College, a place dedicated to inspiring tomorrow's leaders by teaching them about the heroic leaders of the past. How perfect, then, that Roosevelt House will host the Churchill Literary Series that begins tonight and that will continue at Roosevelt House over the next few years. FDR and Churchill were not only two of the great leaders of the 20th century, but also the closest of friends. The personal and political were rarely as intertwined. As Churchill once said, "No lover ever studied every whim of his mistress as I did those of President Roosevelt." Because of the vision and generosity of the series sponsor, Tina Flaherty, Churchill experts and novices alike will join together at Roosevelt House to listen to the lectures and readings from Churchill's speeches and writings. What a wonderful way to introduce a new generation of Americans to the quintessential British statesman. We are thrilled that so many high school and college students, like those here tonight, will seize the incredible opportunity Tina has made possible. Tina told me that she conceived of the series in the shower, which reminded me of when FDR coined the term United Nations and sold it to Churchill by barging in on him in his bath at the White House. In both cases, there must have been something in the water, because we can't imagine a more brilliant way to explore and celebrate the Churchill legacy. Tina's own legacy will be celebrated for generations to come. A trailblazer in the male-dominated world of business, Tina has been at the head of corporate table for decades. She's been the first female vice president of three of America's leading corporations, an award-winning author, and a journalist. Tina's creation and sponsorship of this series is one more example of her extraordinary philanthropy. So many organizations around New York have been fortunate beneficiaries of Tina's generosity. Hunter, where Tina has already created the Irish Voices series, is proud to be one of them. Tina truly understands how innovative philanthropy can deepen our knowledge, raise our awareness, awaken us to the lessons of history, expose us to the pinnacles of art, and inspire us to transform our world. I can't think of a greater gift. Tina, on behalf of everyone in this room and all the students and lifelong learners who will take part in this series, we thank you for this wonderful gift and for your role in keeping alive the extraordinary legacy of statesman, author, and hero, Sir Winston Churchill. It is a pleasure to welcome Tina Flaherty.
Thank you. It's a treat to be introduced by you, Jennifer. Well, I really want to thank all of you in this room, too, for choosing to honor us with your presence. You know, we have so many choices in New York. There's so many things we could do, and we're just so pleased that you chose to join us tonight. I definitely think you made the right choice, because to hear Celia Sandys' beautiful and heartfelt words will be a real treat when she speaks of her grandfather, Sir Winston Churchill. Now, at the very beginning of my remarks, I'm going to share with you a hard truth. I'm just going to come right out and say it. I am in love with Winston Churchill. He's definitely my kind of man, for sure. But you know something? I do tell people this. I really do worship at the Church of Churchill, so to speak. But it's on a very serious note that I do share with you that it's really my honor and my privilege to do everything I can to help celebrate and perpetuate his legacy. If I may, I will highlight the three areas where his words were and are so important. Churchill's words have inspired many of us during very, very difficult times and tough times, which I can personally attest to. Who could forget Mayor Giuliani quoting Churchill during the difficult days after 9/11? Secondly, Churchill's words have moved nations to action. That's in times of enormous challenge. Churchill's words, according to President John F. Kennedy, who was paraphrasing Edward R. Murrow, mobilized the English language and sent it into battle. Speaking of battles, Churchill helped in large part to make possible the anniversary we're celebrating this week. It was 68 years ago, on June 6, 1944, that the Allied forces landed on the shores of Normandy at dawn. This decisive battle, as you all know, ended Hitler's dream of Nazi domination. When you think about it, it was Churchill and his words that first galvanized and sustained British morale in the face of impossible odds. Who's not felt their backbone stiffen and nodded their head in agreement upon hearing Churchill defiantly declare, "If you're going through hell, keep going." See, he was going to tell you many of these things later on, but I just wanted to give you just a taste of it. Churchill once described the British people as having a lion's heart. He said that he was the lucky one who was called upon to give the roar. Let's hope that Churchill's roar will reach each and every one of you in this room, inspiring you to reach high and to hope deeply. And who better to reintroduce us to the legacy of his roar than Sir Winston's granddaughter, my friend Celia Sandys. Having traveled with Churchill as a young girl, Celia has unique insights into this larger-than-life figure as both a powerful leader and a beloved grandfather. I wish I had had the privilege of knowing Churchill, but I can tell you right out front that I have never met a Churchill that I didn't like, including Celia. When I first discovered that Celia and I were born on the same day, May 18th, our compatibility made even more sense. We are both Tauruses, a couple of bulls, I guess you could say, Taurus the bull, and we are unafraid to seize life by the horns. And neither was Winston Churchill, the real star of this evening. It was his leadership that helped save Western civilization from the tyranny of Hitler. Celia is the perfect person to speak with us about her grandfather's ability to lead for three reasons. She saw firsthand Winston Churchill's leadership. Secondly, she chronicled his leadership in 5 books of her own, one of which was developed into a groundbreaking PBS documentary, Chasing Churchill, In Search of My Grandfather. Because Celia's insight and Celia's work has done so much to keep her grandfather's roar echoing throughout the ages. Indeed, Celia still follows in her grandfather's footsteps, and she even leads Chasing Churchill tours. This year, I've heard that Celia is visiting the Dardanelles, and next year, it's Marrakesh for the 70th anniversary of the Casablanca Conference. So if you go on this tour, I can tell you you'll learn a lot, but you'll also laugh a lot because Celia's a lot of fun. You'll find out for sure. Tonight, Celia will share with you her unique perspective about the characteristics that made Churchill a leader for the ages, his courage, his impatience with bullies, and his generosity, and his passion for life. Please join me in welcoming my friend, Celia Sandys.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you all so much for coming. It's a real treat to be here in the Morgan Library, which is absolutely beautiful. And I'm honored and delighted to have been invited to give the inaugural lecture of the Tina Santi Flaherty Literary Series. I don't know where Tina's got to there. Thank you very much for your powerful introduction. I'd like to thank William Griswold and the Morgan Library and Museum for hosting us this evening, Hunter College for organizing the series, and of course, Tina for her generous sponsorship. Some of you may have already seen the exhibition, but for those who haven't, it is fabulous, with a wonderful array of exhibits, from the heartbreaking childhood letters to the papers of honorary citizenship of the United States of America. This is the result of a very happy partnership between the Churchill Archives at Cambridge and the Morgan Library. The bulk of the exhibits come from the Churchill Archives, whose director, Alan Packwood, is the brilliant curator of the exhibition. From the National Trust at Chartwell, and as a generous loan from the private collection of Kenneth Rendell. I'd like to thank them all and all those who have been involved in this extraordinary exhibition, so aptly called The Power of Words. This evening, I will bring you some examples of how my grandfather inspired and led by his very powerful words. In this election year, you will hear more than enough words from politicians whose very fate hangs on the construction and delivery of their speeches. Maybe some of them will take a bit of note and advice from how Winston Churchill constructed and delivered his. Most people know that my grandfather was the master of words, spoken and written. And as a politician, his speeches became some of the most famous ever made. As a journalist and author, he supported his family and his own lifelong, extravagant lifestyle. He famously stated here in New York at the Plaza Hotel, "I am a man of simple taste, easily satisfied by the best." Whenever he needed some money, he picked up his pen. His children used to say, "We lived from pen to mouth." During his life, he wrote more than 44 books and countless articles and was awarded the Nobel Prize for Literature. The impact of my grandfather's words during World War II was more powerful than any weapon. As Tina said, on making Winston Churchill an honorary citizen of the United States of America, President Kennedy said, "He mobilized the English language and sent it into battle." Whether speaking in the House of Commons or on the radio, the effect was profound. So many people have told me how his speeches gave them hope when they were in despair. And wherever they listened, whether here in the United States, whether in London during the Blitz, or hiding out in occupied Europe, listening to radios, which would have been their death sentence if they'd been discovered. Everyone remembers those moments. And for some people, it was their first conscious moment, their listening with their parents to the ritual of Winston Churchill on the radio. He knew that the only way that he could inspire people was to make them believe that he believed that victory was possible. As time passed, following his death in 1965, Winston Churchill became an historical figure who fewer and fewer people could actually remember. Then, following the tragic events of September the 11th, he stepped right out of the history books and back onto the international stage where he had spent so much of his long life. Leaders everywhere called on the inspiration and example of Winston Churchill. The speeches of President George W. Bush and Prime Minister Tony Blair rang out with Churchillian tones, confirming that Winston Churchill's inspiring leadership are as relevant today as they were in 1940. Whether faced by the global financial crisis, the Eurozone disaster, or the war in Afghanistan, the constant cry is, we need another Churchill. So why is it that leadership is so sought after now? It's always important, but there seems to be something about the present age that makes it more important than ever. The answer, I believe, is change. The world is always changing, but every so often it goes through a period of very rapid change. Change that can be disorienting. Change that can seem threatening. Where are things going? What kind of world will we be living in 20 years from now, or even in five? Leadership is about change. The very best leaders are those who are able to deal with change, but can also anticipate it. Leaders who can make sense of what is happening and look ahead, explain the situation to others, and offer a vision of how to move forward. The 1930s and 40s were such a time. Churchill was not only able to lead his country in its darkest hour, he was also the most articulate interpreter of what was happening and what was likely to happen. He saw before most what Hitler represented and what Hitler wanted to do. A few years later, he saw more clearly than most what the post-war period would be like. And his famous Iron Curtain speech, much criticized at the time, showed him at his perceptive best, a leader who was every bit as good at analyzing developments as he was at leading people through them. These skills come to the fore in times like the present, when everything seems to be changing, from safety in our cities, to the climate, to the internet-driven revolution in the way we do business, and in the way we relate to our friends and even to our families. These are times when we need the best leadership we can get to deal with the threats that face us and to seize the opportunities. Churchill became Prime Minister at the age of 65 in the most daunting circumstances imaginable. Hitler's blitzkrieg was overrunning continental Europe. Britain was about to stand alone. Strong leaders welcome a challenge. This is how Churchill described his emotions at the time.
I felt as if I were walking with destiny, and that all my past life had been but a preparation for this hour and for this trial. 11 years in the political wilderness had freed me from ordinary party antagonisms. My warnings over the last 6 years had been so numerous, so detailed, and were now so terribly vindicated that no one could gainsay me. I could not be reproached either for making the war or with want of preparation for it. I thought I knew a good deal about it all, and I was sure I should not fail. Therefore, although impatient for the morning, I slept soundly and had no need for cheering dreams. Facts are better than dreams.
In this speech, my grandfather was reflecting the fact that his whole life had been devoted to inspiring leadership. The most well-known examples of leadership in his life come from his political and military activities, but these translate seamlessly into any other sort of leadership. The main pillars of his leadership were courage, integrity, vision, and communication. Of these, the prime characteristic was courage, of which he wrote, "Courage is rightly esteemed the first of human qualities, because it is the quality which guarantees all the others. It is moral rather than physical courage that is most important for great leaders, for upon it depends the leader's integrity. Integrity is probably the element that is most questioned in politics today. No one displayed greater integrity than Churchill, the politician. He believed in and followed certain principles, but at the same time reserved the right to change his mind, which he explained like this. The only way a man can remain consistent during changing circumstances is to change with them while reserving the same dominating purpose." In 1904, as a young politician, he preached the merits of free trade at a time when his party was bent on protection. Despite the fact that he had a bright future in the Conservative Party, he took the considerable political risk of leaving that party and joining the Liberals, with whom he remained for 20 years. 25 years later, having by then filled half a dozen high posts, first as a Liberal and then once more as a Conservative, which he described that he'd ratted and then he'd re-ratted, Churchill's integrity led to his exclusion from office for the next 10 years. At the beginning of the 1930s, he opposed the government's plan to grant India near independence within the British Empire. And we may judge with hindsight that he was mistaken over India, but what was not in doubt was his integrity. He remained at odds with his party through the 1930s as he warned unsuccessfully against the threat of a resurgent Germany. As a result, he was left in the wilderness until he was found to be indispensable to his country in its darkest hour. Then, with Churchill as Prime Minister, the nation saw leadership as it had never been seen before. And he addressed Parliament honestly.
"I would say to the House, as I said to those who joined the government, I have nothing to offer but blood, toil, tears, and sweat. We have before us an ordeal of the most grievous kind. We have before us many, many long months of struggle and of suffering. You ask what is our policy? I will say it is to wage war by sea, land, and air with all our might, with all the strength that God can give us, to wage war against a monstrous tyranny never surpassed in the dark and lamentable catalogue of human crime. That is our policy. You ask, what is our aim? I can answer in one word, victory. Victory at all costs. Victory in spite of all terror. Victory however long and hard the road may be. But without victory, there is no survival."
There were those who, unable to see the way to victory, were disposed to make a deal with Hitler. Stamping his leadership on a wavering government, Churchill explained the grim situation before concluding, "If this Long Island story of ours is to end at last, let it end only when each of us lies choking in his own blood upon the ground." There was spontaneous approval. Britain would fight on.
We shall go on to the end. We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
There are two lessons to be learned for all leaders from Churchill's political career through the 30s. From his stand over India, not to persist in unwinnable battles, but from his opposition to appeasement, to stick to one's guns when faced with a threat to one's fundamental interests. As a leader, Churchill's vision ranged over a wide field. Most significant was his strategic vision of American involvement in the defense of the free world. As early as August 1940, the House of Commons heard his views on this subject.
Undoubtedly, this process means that these two great organizations of the English-speaking democracies, the British Empire and the United States, will have to be somewhat mixed up together in some of their affairs for mutual and general advantage. For my own part, looking out upon the future, I do not view the process with any misgivings. I could not stop it if I wished. No one can stop it. Like the Mississippi, it just keeps rolling along. Let it roll. Let it roll on, full flood, inexorable, irresistible, benignant, to broader lands and better days.
My grandfather's political vision had been demonstrated as a young journalist in 1900, when during the Anglo-Boer War, the tide turned in favor of the British. He advocated magnanimity towards the defeated enemy. The establishment was outraged by this, and the war continued. It would take almost 50 more years before magnanimity would be generally recognized as the best policy for the victorious. When in 1911 he became First Lord of the Admiralty, he met the sort of problem and opposition that newly appointed leaders often encounter. There was the need to reorganize the staff of the most powerful navy in the world. This was a task that Churchill carried out with tact, moving some respected figures sideways rather than retiring them in order to retain their support. The larger the vision, the greater the catastrophe should it fail. Churchill's vision in 1915 fueled the only original strategic idea in World War I. This was the Dardanelles campaign in the Eastern Mediterranean, designed to outflank the enemy and secure victory without the slaughter of trench warfare. It failed largely because Churchill's authority did not match the responsibilities he had assumed. Here is a lesson for ambitious leaders impatient to make their mark. It was the lowest point in his life. My grandfather said, "I thought it would kill him." He had the Dardanelles in mind when he later wrote, "Everyone threw the blame on me. I have noticed they nearly always do. I suppose it's because they think that I shall be able to bear it best." When visionaries fail, they inevitably bounce back. At the age of 41, Churchill rejoined the army and went to fight in the trenches. Within 3 years, he was back in the cabinet. He once said something that I think a lot of us can really relate to. "I am always ready to learn, although I do not always like being taught." The Dardanelles rankled with him ever after, but he applied the lessons from it when, in World War II, he ensured that all the elements of the war effort were fully coordinated. In 1959, when I was cruising with him on Aristotle Onassis's yacht in the Mediterranean, it was decided to go through the Dardanelles at dead of night so that he wouldn't know where we were. The next morning, he said to me, "They thought I wouldn't know where we were." But of course I did. He was not easily fooled. And of course, he loved maps, so would have been following the journey from point to point on his maps. The list of Churchill's visionary innovations is long and varied. Pension schemes and social security in the early 1900s, the tank and naval aviation in World War I, the promoting of radar before World War II, and the Mulberry Harbours for D-Day are just a few. He was never frightened of questioning the experts and experimenting. At the end of World War II, he found himself once more out of office. But by then, he commanded the world stage, and his warning of the Cold War in a speech at Fulton, Missouri, epitomized his courage and his vision. He knew that in the aftermath of war, his words would not be what the Western world wanted to hear.
From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia. All these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere. What is needed is a settlement. And the longer this is delayed, the more difficult it will be, and the greater our danger will become. From what I have seen of our Russian friends and allies during the war, I am convinced that there is nothing they admire so much as strength. And there is nothing for which they have less respect than for weakness, especially military weakness.
At the time, Churchill's words attracted universal criticism. But within a year, his analysis had been widely acknowledged as correct. Vision and courage to challenge convention count for little if a leader cannot convey his or her ideas clearly and convincingly. Even today, 60 years after the event, you can listen to my grandfather's words without ever wondering, what on earth did he mean by that? This is what he said when praising the fighter pilots in 1940 during the Battle of Britain.
The gratitude of every home in our island, in our empire, and indeed throughout the world, except in the abodes of the guilty, goes out to the British airmen who, undaunted by odds, unwearied in their constant challenge and mortal danger, are turning the tide of the world war by their prowess and by their devotion. Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.
Unlike many modern leaders, he did not try to spin a loss into a win. In 1940, he could have construed the unexpectedly successful evacuation. Instead, he told the story straight with this warning to Parliament.
Sir, we must be very careful not to assign to this deliverance the attributes of a victory. Wars are not won by evacuation.
Great leaders bring out the inner strength that people often do not know that they possess. It's been said that Hitler could persuade you that he could do anything, but that Churchill could persuade you that you could do anything. Churchill gave each and every man and woman an heroic role to play. And this is how he challenged the British people to give their all when Britain stood alone.
I expect that the Battle of Britain is about to begin. Upon this battle depends the survival of Christian civilization. Upon it depends our own British life and the long continuity of our institutions and our empire. The whole fury and might of the enemy must very soon be turned on us. Hitler knows that he will have to break us in this island or lose the war. If we can stand up to him, all Europe may be free, and the life of the world may move forward into broad, sunlit uplands. But if we fail, than the whole world, including the United States, including all that we have known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age, made more sinister and perhaps more protracted by the lights of perverted science. Let us, therefore, brace ourselves to our duties, and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
Present-day leaders in all spheres can take heart from the fact that Churchill was not a naturally gifted speaker. Early on, he tried to overcome a speech impediment, a difficulty in pronouncing the letter S. He went to see a specialist saying, I'm in the army now, but will enter politics later. I cannot spend my whole life avoiding the letter S. In fact, his difficulty with the letter S never went away and became a trademark for him. So people listening to him on the radio were absolutely certain that it was him. As a young man, he could be heard walking up and down reciting, the Spanish ships I cannot see, for they are not in sight. He learned from others. Age 21, passing through New York City, he struck up a friendship with Burke Cochran, a distinguished lawyer and politician. Churchill said of Cochran's political oratory, he was my model. I learned from him how to hold thousands in thrall, how modest he was, to put it at only thousands. As an orator, Churchill's prodigious memory was a tremendous advantage, but it did not remove the need for preparation. He spent hours rehearsing his speeches in front of a mirror. And once, his valet thought he heard my grandfather calling to him from the bath. And on inquiring what was needed, he was told, I wasn't speaking to you, I was addressing the House of Commons. In his acceptance speech for an honorary degree at Harvard, he raised a laugh from the audience when he seemed accidentally to say the infernal combustion engine. He quickly corrected it to the internal combustion engine, but his secretary told me she'd overheard him practicing the mistake on the train from Washington. My grandfather did not use speechwriters. His close friend, F.E. Smith, the Earl of Birkenhead, said Winston has devoted the best years of his life to making impromptu speeches. There are lessons here for modern leaders whose speeches often betray their origin in committee. Communication skills apply not only in the delivery of soaring speeches, but also in commonplace everyday events. Churchill's wit was a useful part of his armory. When an opposing speaker in a parliamentary debate noticed that Churchill was apparently dozing, he said, must you sleep when I am speaking? Churchill, without opening his eyes, replied, no, it is purely voluntary. And reflecting on his less than perfect education when receiving an honorary degree in Miami, he said, no one has passed so few examinations and received so many degrees. He had great respect, and almost old-fashioned respect for women, but from time to time they drove him to make them the object of his sharp wit. One day he was at a state banquet in Richmond, Virginia, and chicken was being served. So when the butler came round the table with the dish and said, what part of the bird would you like? He said, I'd like breast, please. The rather stuffy lady sitting next to him said, Mr. Churchill, in this country we call it white meat or dark meat. The next morning she received a little bunch of flowers with a note saying, please pin this on your white meat.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know sometimes when we go, I know definitely people like hearing the speeches that they know, and people sometimes like hearing the tunes that they know best. So, you know, I'm afraid I'm going to tell you two things that he said, which a lot of you will know, but those of you who don't know ought to know them. One day in the House of Commons, Bessie Braddock, a Labour MP, went up to my grandfather and said, "Winston, you're drunk." To which he replied, "Yes, madam, but you are ugly." "And tomorrow morning, I will be sober, but you will still be ugly." And the first American woman to become a member of the House of Commons, Lady Astor, said, "Winston, if you were my husband, I would put poison in your coffee." To which he immediately replied, "And if you were my wife, I would drink it." Serious speeches were leavened with humor. When surveying the war in a speech to the Canadian Parliament at the end of 1941, he recounted his words to the government of France.
"When I warned them that Britain would fight on alone, whatever they did, their general told their prime minister and his divided cabinet, 'In 3 weeks, England will have her neck wrung like a chicken. Some chicken.' Some neck."
And without pomposity, his wit dealt with the sort of tricky situation which leaders sometimes find themselves. One day, he was sitting at the margins of a wartime conference, taking a bit of time off, and an inebriated GI put his face around the door and said, "Hey, fatso, where's the John?" To which the Prime Minister replied, "Turn left down the passage, and there's a door on the right marked gentleman. But please, don't let that deter you." I was told that story in the White House by someone who'd been there. Courage, integrity, vision, and his ability to communicate were the main pillars of Churchill's leadership, but there were other important elements. In his first 6 weeks as Prime Minister, he made 5 dangerous flights to France in the hope of putting steel into the French government, which was on the point of collapse. This was just the beginning. During the course of the war, he went to Canada 3 times, to Moscow 2x, here to America 6 times, to Tehran, Casablanca, and Yalta, in addition to visit the battlefronts of the Western Desert, Italy, and Normandy. On one occasion, he was in an unpressurized aircraft, and he insisted that the oxygen mask was adapted so that he could breathe in the oxygen and puff away at his Havana cigar. When he became Prime Minister in 1940, he relegated to the past the mistakes of his predecessors by declaring to Parliament, "If we open a quarrel between the past and the present, we shall find we have lost the future." Of allies, he said, "When one looks at the disadvantages attaching to alliances, one must not forget how superior are the advantages." In business, as in war, pragmatism will determine the best form of alliance. When Russia was invaded by Germany in 1941, he reconciled his support for Russia with his loathing of communism by declaring, "If Hitler invaded hell, I would at least make favorable reference to the devil in the House of Commons." Strong leaders should never appear desperate, as we see from Churchill's courtship of President Roosevelt in the 2 years of war before Pearl Harbor. With Europe overrun, it seemed that Britain would soon succumb, causing Roosevelt to hesitate in sending the material help which Churchill sought. The Prime Minister's advisers suggested passing British technical secrets wholesale in exchange for more rapid assistance. Churchill demurred, saying, "If an exchange is to be arranged, I should like to carry it out piece by piece. In March 1941, the Lend-Lease Act was passed, and Congress thereby fulfilled Churchill's famous plan in a broadcast largely aimed at American audiences.
Put your confidence in us. Give us your faith and your blessing. And under Providence, all will be well. We shall not fail or falter. We shall not weaken or tire. Neither the sudden shock of battle nor the long-drawn trials of vigilance and exertion will wear us down. Give us the tools, and we will finish the job.
How does a leader under enormous pressure relieve the stress? This was my grandfather's recipe. Change is the master key. The cultivation of a hobby and new forms of interest is therefore a policy of first importance to a public man. He was a man of many interests, but his favorite diversion was painting. I was with him when he put the final brushstrokes to one of his last paintings, a dazzling still life of oranges and lemons. Whenever I look at it, I hope that he's up there on his cloud, fulfilling for his ambition for the afterlife, which was this. I know of nothing which, without exhausting the body, more entirely absorbs the mind. When I get to heaven, I mean to spend a considerable portion of my first million years in painting and so get to the bottom of the subject. All leaders need someone with whom they can discuss their fears and successes, someone who will back them up when they're right and yet tell them when they're getting things wrong. For Churchill, it was his wife, Clementine. In 1940, she became so alarmed that his temper was suffering under the strain, and even though she was living under the same roof, she wrote him a letter. Perhaps she thought she wouldn't get the message out if she said it in person. My darling, I hope you will forgive me if I tell you something which I feel you ought to know. One of the men in your entourage, a devoted friend, has been to me and told me that there is a danger of you being generally disliked by your colleagues and subordinates because of your rough and overbearing manner. It seems your private secretaries have agreed to behave like schoolboys and take what's coming to them and then escape out of your presence, shrugging their shoulders. Higher up, if an idea is suggested, say at a conference, you are supposed to be so contemptuous that presently no ideas, good or bad, will be forthcoming. I was astonished and upset, because in all these years, I've been accustomed to all those who have worked with and under you, loving you. I said this, and I was told, no doubt, it's the strain. My darling Winston, I must confess that I have noticed a deterioration in your manner, and you are not so kind as you used to be. It is for you to give the orders, and if they are bungled, except for the King, the Archbishop of Canterbury, and the Speaker, you can sack anyone and everyone. Therefore, with this terrific power, you must combine urbanity, kindness, and if possible, Olympic calm. I cannot bear that those who serve the country and yourself should not love you as well as admire and respect you. Please forgive your loving and devoted and watchful Clemmy. Without my grandmother, history might have taken a different course. All modern leaders can benefit from the example set by Winston Churchill. I believe that his principles of leadership are as relevant today as they were in 1940 and are an inspiration to anyone in any field who aspires to lead. I'm going to finish with a poem, which is a tribute written by his friend and colleague Duff Cooper, which really summed up how the British people, despite voting him out of office after the war, felt about him. And I think many people here in America felt the same. When ears were deaf and tongues were mute, you told of doom to come. When others fingered on the flute, you thundered on the drum. When armies marched and cities burned, and all you said came true, those who had mocked your warnings turned, almost too late, to you. And doubt gave way to firm belief, and through five cruel years, you gave us glory in our grief and laughter through our tears. When final honors are bestowed and last accounts are done, then shall we know how much was owed by all the world to one. Thank you very much. Bravo. Come on, Alan.
Of course, all of those leadership and communication characteristics that you were talking about. It's been my privilege to work with Celia now for many years. I'm Alan Packwood. I'm lucky enough to be the director of the Churchill Archive Centre. But I also have another ad hoc occasional role, and that's as travelling companion and support act for Celia. And it's a role that I'm going to reprise now because we're going to adjourn to the chairs for questions, and after questions, Celia will be in the foyer signing copies of her book and able to carry on the dialogue. But let's start with the questions now.
Am I going here or here?
You go now. Okay, now we have two microphones on either side of the hall. And if I can ask you, if you have a question, if you would raise your hand and if you can wait for the microphone to come to you. When the microphone comes to you, if you can give your name, and if you can also keep your questions as succinct as possible, because we only have a limited amount of time, and I'm certain after that presentation there are going to be a lot of questions. So can we have a first question, please? Yeah, okay. Okay, so we have a question from a lady over here in the middle. Now, if you can wait for the microphone to come to you, because we're recording.
Hi, my name is Kathleen, and I wonder what it would be like as a grandfather. Is he accessible? Is he warm? Is he sitting in his lap? Is he a gentleman? He always reminded me of my grandfather. I wonder what he was like as your grandfather.
Well, he was certainly... what you have to understand is he had very little family life himself as a child, so he greatly treasured the family life that he could have and wanted to give his family what he hadn't had. And I think that his greatest pleasure probably was to be sitting around the dining room table at Chartwell and seeing as many of his descendants there as possible. And so that he really enjoyed. As children, we used to love going with him to feed the goldfish and do all the simple things. You know, people often ask, you know, did he talk about the war or this sort of thing? And really what we'd like doing was going to feed the fish and visit the black swans and to go for a walk with his poodle, who was called Rufus.
Okay, next question. Okay, we have at the back.
Can you tell us whether, Gerald Walpin, can you tell us whether when he lost the election after the victory in Europe, what his mentality and his feelings were like?
Well, I can tell you that two of his secretaries, Elizabeth Leighton and Patrick Kinner, told me that they were sitting with him in Downing Street, and although everyone else seemed to have known what was going to happen, it seemed that he hadn't really cottoned on that things were that bad. But they said that the three of them sat there and cried. He wasn't one to worry about shedding a tear, and so they all had a good cry together. Then he went off on a painting holiday to Lake Como to stay in Alexander's, Field Marshal Alexander's house.
Okay, now it's quite difficult to see your raised hands in the darkness from here. Can you raise your hands right up if you've got a question? Okay, gentlemen, over on this side up here.
disappeared.
Well, the question was what accounted for Churchill's success in being re-elected as a Prime Minister in 1951? And Celia's just asked me if I can start the answer off here. I would say part of the answer here is Churchill's own perseverance and determination. I think there was nothing more likely to make him persevere than a setback. And of course, the 1945 election defeat was a setback. And I think thereafter, he was determined to come back and he was determined to seek re-election and he was determined to be elected as a peacetime prime minister. So although by the time he is re-elected in 1951, he's in his 70s, you know, he keeps going. It is that never give in spirit. Another factor, of course, is that you have the austerity after the Second World War. You have the implementation of rationing. You have this period. And I think by the 1950s, people wanted a bit more glamour back in their lives, would you agree? A bit more excitement. Mm-hmm. And I think there was a feeling that, you know, Churchill was a great character. He remained a great character on the world stage. And he could allow or help Britain to box above its weight. And so I think there was a desire to see him back in, playing that role, and a role, of course, that he was delighted to play.
Well, I remember, and I'm sure my sister Edwina, who was sitting where she was instructed, right at the back of the class, I'm sure she remembers, I vividly remember that night in 1951 when the election was won, because our father also had been out of office from 1945. And so, I mean, it was the first sort of political excitement that I remember in my life, how thrilled everyone was that as the results came in, you know, that the Conservatives were in, and therefore both our father and, of course, our grandfather was Prime Minister once again.
And when was your first visit to Downing Street? Do you remember that?
Well, I mean, I'm sure that I visited Downing Street in the war, but I don't remember that.
Okay, gentleman down here in the third row.
You mentioned the criticality. Can you talk into the microphone?
You mentioned the criticality of the Dardanelles campaign, even through 1959. What were his feelings about it? Was he angry that it had ended so quickly because a couple of French battleships got blown up? Was it sadness because of the Australians killed it deliberately? Or was it something else entirely?
I think I will pass this one to Alan.
Okay, well, I mean, just making sure, first of all, that everyone heard the question. The question was about the Dardanelles and what it was that upset Churchill so much about the Dardanelles and how he reacted to that. I mean, this, of course, you have to remember, is the first major setback in what up until that point had been a meteoric rise and career. You know, elected to the House of Commons, aged just 24, in the British Cabinet at 33. He'd already served as President of the Board of Trade, Home Secretary, and First Lord of the Admiralty. And so this was the first time that he'd really had a huge political setback. It was an operation that he was involved with, that he passionately supported, that he advocated. And of course, it was one that he ultimately took responsibility for, and when Asquith was forced to restructure his government, it was Churchill that paid the price. But I think, you know, what made him feel particularly sore about this was that it brought him down, and yet he continued to see and to argue that this was an operation that could have brought the war to a close at an earlier date. Of course, you have to put yourself, I think, back in the mindset of the time. If you're a member of the British Cabinet, you're receiving reports on a daily basis of the horrible atrocities that are taking place on the Western Front with all of these enormous offensives. Surely you're going to consider it one of your first duties to try and find a way out of that terrible, terrible slaughter, a way of bringing the war to an end quicker. Churchill was First Lord of the Admiralty. He was very keen to see the Navy engaged and active. And, you know, he was using his very active mind to look around and try and find other ways to bring the fight to the enemy. And of course, this is a trait that you can see all the way through his life. I mean, he believed in taking the fight to the enemy. He believed in the offensive spirit. And that's what's motivating. And I think, you know, when this goes wrong and when it has such a devastating effect on his own political career, he feels it very keenly. And he feels it particularly keenly, of course, because, you know, he still feels that what motivated this operation was right, and that the potential risks were worth it, and in this case.
Do you want to? Yeah, you've done it perfectly. couldn't do it.
Okay, we've got a question up there.
Can you tell us if Churchill's American heritage affected his character?
I think that'll be the last question, don't you? Well, I think very definitely whether it affected his character. I'm sure it affected his characteristics and how he did things, because most British children born into a family like the Marlboroughs would have, if you ever hear how they spoke, they all spoke in rather what I'd call rather a poncy way. And he certainly didn't. He spoke in a much more normal, everyday way. His mother, obviously, was a much more relaxed person than, for instance, any of her Churchill sisters-in-law, who she didn't like at all. And she was, whatever else she was beautiful and she was unstuffy. And so therefore, I think she gave a whole breath of fresh air to the family. He was very proud of his American heritage and loved it. And from his first visit here in 1895, he absolutely fell in love with America, which he then described as my other country. And of course, when he went to address Congress in 1941, January 41, or was it later?
December 41.
December 41, he said, if my mother had been British and my father American instead of the other way around, I might have got here on my own. Of course, he would have been hoping to be president. He would have enjoyed that very much.
Okay, well, ladies and gentlemen, I think you can see that those Churchillian genes, American and British, are still going strong, and I would ask you to join me in thanking Celia Sandys for that wonderful presentation.
Thank you very much. I've got my bag there. I'm going to go back there and come around. Good.
Oh.